Welcome to the voice of Bolt Business Radio, the show about ways to stay competitive in a changing market, break through business plateaus, and respond to the changing expectations of today's customers. Your host, Jess Dewell, is a rapid growth entrepreneur, consultant, and business advocate with a 20-year track record of business excellence. She candidly discusses how to achieve your growth strategy and realize your company's unfulfilled potential. Now, here's Jess.
Hello and welcome to the Voice of Bold Business Radio. I'm your host, Jess Dewell, and today we're talking about stay the course. As the founder of Red Direction, I bring you over 20 years of advising, consulting, and facilitating growth strategy. Companies that work with me learn to ask the right questions and think effectively on their feet. I am a business advocate of yours, and I specialize in working in companies that are at critical points of development to balance growth with constraints found in leadership and operations. So when we don't know what we don't know, and when we're hit with the unexpected, like today's change of schedule could be one of them, a different part of our life maybe has something uproaring and taking all of our attention and energy, even if we're joyously and courageously riding the waves or hanging on to our magic carpet as we are, we're along for the ride. Whatever's surrounding us impacts the decisions that we're making. And we can more easily make decisions that take us off mission when we have so much going on. So this discernment, this conversation to have today about staying the course is, what are we doing in our daily activities so that we may stay on task, on target? And that means during times of the most change, regardless of what's surrounding that change, the most growth, what's surrounding that growth becomes second nature. The skills are becoming second nature, so we can pull them, we can grab them, we can jump in and rely on everything we've practiced because we have other stuff that our mind must chew on. Now with me today, Scott is taking the co-host seat. I'm really glad you're here, Scott. It's going to be a great conversation.
Well, I'm looking forward to this too. It's usually I'm in the background switching between cameras and doing some other things, but occasionally get to share a co-host seat with you, kind of taking us back to the early days when we were experimenting with live streaming when it was brand new to the internet.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. And you know what? Those days are so fun. In fact, it was really funny because we were just talking about JSY offline the other day, and I actually was thinking about some of our shows. I had to do some server-side website update things over at Liquid Web, and I was like, oh, look, there's the JSY, and I was doing the stuff, and I was checking the site, and a whole bunch of stuff came back to me after I had had that dream. So this is like the third time in 5 days that JSY has come up.
Isn't that interesting? Well, I'm going to ask a favor. As you know, we are experimenting with expanding the Voice of Bold Business outreach, and there's a brand new, at least it's new to us, outlet, which is called Himalaya.fm, and it's a podcast service that is all over the world. And I uploaded 8 of our episodes yesterday to it, and it's live and ready to go. Could you put in the program notes how to find us, the JSY show? And I'm sure that it's the best of JSY, so I'm sure that many of the viewers of VBB will enjoy and benefit from those programs as well.
You know what? I think this is a perfect thing to ask. And yes, it will go in the program notes because you'll send me the link of what to what to put in the program notes. And you got it, Scott. And beyond that, yeah, here's the thing. We have so much content that as we've plotted the course for 2019 and we've plotted the course out several years after that, I haven't put a year to it, so I'm going to right now, 2025. Sounds so far away. But you know, next year is 2020, which also sounds really far away.
Yeah.
So it's only 6 years from now. But we've plotted this course. We know where we want to take it. We know what we want to do with the show. And being able to use, you're right, Scott, the Jess plus Scott plus you show as a way to test new avenues is the related content that gives us a platform to play with so that we can expand the way that we want quickly and efficiently for the Voice of Bold business. I love we are relying on what we've done in the past.
In other words, what you're doing is you're staying the course.
You're exactly right. You couldn't resist, could you?
No, I couldn't. It's just like the old times, huh?
I know. Exactly. Oh my gosh. Exactly. So part of staying the course and how this is coming together today, we're going to share some really important information. So there are going to be three key areas to the program today. The first is finding problems before they're all consuming. The second is decide how communication looks and sounds in your organization. And the third is a recap of how present retreat also fits this conversation of staying the course. And within that, we have all kinds of things to discuss, including there's going to be some video clips, there will be some sharing of some tips, there's probably going to be references that we will also be making copious notes in, of course, notes that go into our show notes as well. So here we are. We are in the middle of staying the course, right? And this is actually apropos on many levels. One, we're talking about the far future for the Voice of Bold Business Radio with Scott's ask for us. Thank you, Scott, for asking. That's a very important thing that we did. And we're also talking about unexpected change. Well, life happens. Things happen. People become unavailable. It doesn't matter how much we plan. It matters what we do when those situations happen because our plans go out the window. Because the way we think, the way we act, the way we respond goes out the window. So I want to honor all parts of this. And so when we're talking about finding problems before they're all consuming, this part is so important. It's important because we have to really honor our emotions and our state of being and our life situation, our own personal experience, all the joy, all the turmoil that we have. And so when I got this email yesterday of what was going on, I was like, okay, no problem. And I had to put it away. And then I just let it be. I totally let it be, and I didn't think about it until this morning when I woke up. And the reason was because there's other stuff happening that also requires a lot of attention and a lot of focus, and that requires energy. And so I had to compartmentalize. So my first thought was, okay, not sure what I'm going to do about this. I felt sad for the situation, and I felt angry at the fact that I didn't know what I was going to do. And I felt overwhelmed because it was just one more thing.
And what you're talking about is the email about the guest who was originally going to be live, but something came up.
Correct. Yeah, exactly. The change, right? This is an everyday change. And so I'm saying these things out loud only for the purpose of saying all those emotions were there. Now, in addition to those emotions that showed up right there, Scott, about this unexpected situation and our change of programming, here's what happened. At the same point in time, I was like, I can totally compartmentalize this because the Voice of Bold Business Radio has processes for this. We have enough information and experience within our team. I'm not worried about this. We have talked about it, gone through it before, learned from it, decided what we wanted it to be. And so I was like, good, I don't have to think about this tomorrow. So there was that, I can't think about it. And at the same time, I don't have to. And by the way, the one is kind of heavy and the other one was very relief oriented. And so in the grand scheme of things, me personally, I came out even and I was able to move on and do the other things that required my attention that day, yesterday. It sounds like so far away.
There's another part of your mindset that I know very well because I adopted it for myself, and I know you'll laugh when I say it.
Okay, I'm gonna not drink tea then.
Yeah, no, don't. I should have waited until you had your cup.
Yeah, you should have.
No. One of the things that you're very fond of saying is, it's all good.
It's true.
And that. Just by saying that releases so much of the boundaries that constrain us when something arises.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. And here's the thing. The only reason I can say that is because I actually believe it. If I said it was all good and I still ran around like a crazy person. Now, when I did finally get around to talking about it, apparently I was a little unclear. Scott goes, some of what you said was really confusing, Jess. And I was like, oh yeah, I know. We got fire hose this morning. Thank you. I'm so glad. I was like, how come nothing happened? And he was like, it was a little confusing. And I was like, okay, got it. Right? Take a step back. Everybody knows we're all on board. It's all good.
It's all
because
good.
The team knows how to work together. We've practiced working together. And we've actually had some hard situations that we've worked through together, which solidify being able to come together quickly in a way that we wouldn't if we had never had situations that we've had to work through before. One of my favorite to talk about is the fact that sometimes I just have really poor internet connection. Well, it's kind of hard being the host of a show that in the location where there is poor internet connection. And Scott helped me get through that. Because there's nothing you can do about it except for give me space to roar and get crazy and go, yeah, okay, so once I can get past the emotion of it, then what? And can I get past the emotion of it quicker? So this finding problems before they're all consuming comes down to the fact that we learn the good things and we learn the bad things, provided we're willing to open our eyes. And when we're thinking about the future, whether that's like tomorrow, the future, or the farther future, like 2025, 6 years from now, right? We have this concept of, well, what do we need to know? What are the problems at hand? The first thing that comes to my mind is, we've been talking about it, and I'm just going to come out and say it, the strengths and weaknesses of our team. The strengths and weaknesses of our team, the hard skills that are part of our team, the soft skills that are a part of our teams. And in this case, our is yours and mine and everybody listening. And it could be your family units, everything, because that's how we know how to approach solving problems. I mean, solving problems is easy. It's four steps. The four steps to solving problems is knowing there's a problem. And then the second step is confirming that that's really the problem, or is that a symptom of a bigger problem? And the third step is going, once we've found the real root problem, then what? What are our options? And what are the things that we are going to include to evaluate those options? And then what? Actually do the thing that was chosen and review it and decide if you liked it. And regardless of the outcome, whether you like it, whether you don't like it, it creates the next set of it allows the next situation to have a different set of problems, to have a different set of challenges, to be able to look under and get to the root. Because when we can find the root problems versus the symptoms, we have the ability to understand quicker what is a symptom and what is a problem. So, are we fighting the right fires? Are we planning with the right information, the one that's going to be the most impactful?
So, one of the themes of the Voice of Bold Business, and I really look forward to the day when we get all of the clips from the, you know, over. Had over 100 guests on the show, and a large percentage of them have talked about when you there's no real such thing as a failure unless you let it defeat you, because if there's a failure on the way and you learn from it, then that actually strengthens your ability to go forward into the future with success. And in fact, there are very few, if any, people who are successful who haven't had that trail of, you know, large and small failures that they learned from.
You used a taboo word, Scott.
What?
Nobody likes to talk about failure anymore. Didn't you know that?
Really? I mean, is this related to the participation awards and, you know, all of that?
Some. Yes, because we've adopted that for ourselves in every generation. I mean, when it shows up, it's fail fast. Well, that's an interesting thing because we have this fear of failure, so we change the word because we don't really want to look at it. And then we have this culture that we see in society and mostly in certain cultures within organizations, and it's to fail fast. It's to take big risks. And in one side, it's the avoidance piece, and the other side, it's it only works when you learn from what you do. I can fail all day long, but if I just let it fail all day long, at what point in time does it become an excuse? You know what I mean?
Well, you know, there are scripts that we have. I mean, one way of looking at it is that there are scripts that we have in our head that we play out over and over and over again. So part of learning from quote-unquote one's failure is to rewrite the script so that you're not just repeating something over and over again. And another theme is it's part of learning from failure is self-forgiveness.
Oh, that's such a big one. And I'm glad you said it. If I said it, I think the initial reaction would be different.
Well, that's an entirely different program.
Yeah. I don't want to necessarily go down that path, but yeah, so talk more about that.
Well, I mean, I don't know if there's much to say beyond that other than I suppose there's one's self-image. And if one, well, it, and then, and well, you're asking me to dig deeper. Part of it is that, this is another theme that's been on the program, and that's we all create, to the most part, our own reality. So as such, if we are, for example, in business or if we're, say, an entrepreneur and our reactions will cause counter reactions, we can be in charge of our destiny. In fact, it's probably pretty hard not to be in charge of our destiny. Two people are on the same path, and 3 years later, they are in entirely different places, and it's the choices that they made during those interim and the big choices and the small choices that take them to different places. And part of it is if I forgive myself for having done something, part of forgiveness, then digging deeper with that, I suppose, is not just say, okay, I'm going to forgive myself and I'm not going to change. There needs to be, there's a word I'm looking for, self-examination. And there's merit in forgiving myself because I'm going to make these different changes because I have these other people in my life that will speak truth to power. Maybe they're mentors, maybe they're other people, but they're the ones who will allow me to do those mid-course corrections that maybe I'm not able to do myself because I'm too close to the situation. Your thoughts?
I'm glad you tossed it back to me. We've moved into the second piece, everybody, and I just want to talk about this to point that out because we're in the place where we're deciding what communication looks and sounds like. One of the things that I notice with entrepreneurs, solo business owners, or business owners that have complete remote teams, and they're all disparate, right? They don't necessarily know about each other. So just kind of putting that out there. This could also be small businesses of up to 5 people. I also see this happen where everybody feels like they have to have the answer all the time. Nobody's willing to look for a problem. Nobody's willing to accept a problem exists. Nobody's willing to recognize the deeper piece of it takes 2 to tango or 5 to tango or whatever it is within our organization. And so how we communicate and more importantly, what we communicate about is determining the way we work together. And the way we work together is further determined by what we prioritize, the actions that we take. And so when we think about this, I'm thinking about, right, you said awareness, and I was like, okay, cool, that we're in this transition space. And so I want to leave it with that for just a minute. I believe clip number three is going to talk about this. We're bringing in the clip numbers won't make sense to the audience, but this is for us internally. Because part of company culture, part of how we decide to show up, the way we show up, what we can expect of the people that we work with, and what the people that we work with can expect from us, is all about and rooted in increasing empathy.
I can honestly say, having done both things, creating a large body of work in the world that I'm very proud of, while simultaneously exploring a huge body of what's inside of me, that the latter was the harder work. But I believe that because I did that work and I continue to do that work, that it improves my external abilities. And it definitely increases my empathy toward others. Because when I recognize how flawed I am, it just gives me so much more compassion toward whatever shortcoming I perceive in another person and want to understand, well, what's driving that?
Whew. And something that she said really resonates true with something that Abigail said on our show as well. This is clip number nine. And talking about dealing with the past.
So many people say it's in the past. Well, if you haven't dealt with it, then it's always this gnawing feeling of something that's coming up from behind, especially abuse. So when you do the hard work, you look in your rearview mirror about what was in your past and what do you need to overcome or what do you need to address. Those are those negative tapes that we all believed is truth. You're never good enough. You're not smart enough. You're too old. You're too young. No one's going to like you. So clear up what was in the past. Clear up what you see in the rearview mirror.
In our team, I think some of us, we want to have all the answers. And I think some of us, and I'm talking about the Red Direction team here. Some of us will stay quiet when there isn't an answer, or it seemed a little scary to talk about something when a particular conversation comes up. And there's a whole bunch of other things. Somebody always comes to the table with an idea. There's always a readiness of, let's just throw something out so we can grab onto it and we can work with something. And I know the higher the emotions, the harder it is to stay in that place of productivity, because it's sometimes awkward to see somebody else vulnerable. Sometimes it's uncomfortable to see somebody cry. By the way, I've cried in my staff meetings before, and you know, it comes with the territory sometimes. And I'd much rather cry with my team than in all by myself, because how will the team really know the depth of what's going on if, for whatever the cry means, it could be happy, it could be sad, it could be overwhelmed, it could be all kind scared, it could be all kinds of things. It could be ecstatic. The point being, though, is whatever those strong emotions are, if they're emotions that we don't typically see and it's not the way we do us, it can be awkward. And being able to have that awkwardness and still be able to work together, being able to have that vulnerability and recognize it is not always smooth sailing in our communication either, makes such a big difference. And we're going to pause, because when we come back, we're going to start talking about self-awareness, and we're going to talk about what we do with all this stuff that we've just shared, right? Building on what we've already done. So you're listening to the Voice of Bold Business Radio. This is program 205, Stay the Course.
You're listening to the Voice of Bold Business Radio. In every program, we share stories, tips, and concepts that benefit short-term goals and increase confidence in long-term positioning. For additional perspectives on your growth strategy, Jess Dewell is your business advisor and consultant. Go to voiceofboldbusiness.com and click the Find Out More button to get started. Now, back to Jess.
Radio@reddirection.com. Provided you are interested in adding your voice to this conversation and you're not interested in the hashtag right now, or you want to share something and you want to get an answer to that, but you want an abbreviated version and you don't want all of the information of your situation to be out on the internet anywhere, that's okay. Send us that email. provided you are ready and happy and sharing and knowing somebody who could benefit from learning the problem-solving skills, learning about what the levels of awareness are and how we can use them to improve our daily productivity and make things more second nature to handle chaos and crazy, the good kind and the bad kind. And what we get to do with that and how we actually practice that, use hashtag VBB Radio, because it's about staying the course, not only today, not only tomorrow, but in 2025, 6 years from now. It's kind of weird to say that. I'm going to keep saying that. I have to embrace that all day today. Awareness. There are three levels of awareness that I have articulated over the course of my career. And once I figured how this shows up for business leaders, I looked other places and saw it in life as well, outside of work, inside volunteer groups, inside community conversations, in our neighborhoods, in our schools, wherever we happen to be. And the three levels of awareness are kind of like this. The first one is when we get done with a situation, we go, oh, there it was again. The first level of awareness is recognizing that there is a pattern and something happens, yet we're seeing it after the fact. The second level, that's kind of the most basic. Okay, cool. Our brain is on, our heart is on, our gut is on. They're recognizing something's going on and we're like, that's happening again. What about this? What's making this happen again? Or here I am, I reacted that way again, whatever it is. It's at the end. We find the pattern at the end. And then there's a point where you're in the middle of it, right? Let's say, I could use another one, you know, anything. There was a day last week that I was putting more fuel in the car. So I was at the gas station, I put in my credit card, and it says, give me your zip code. So I give it the zip code, but I typed in the last number wrong and I hit return before I saw the last number. Well, 3 minutes later, I get to start over. That was the longest 3 minutes I think I've ever experienced. I probably should have just meditated during this time. And I didn't learn it, but here I was in the middle of it having all of these emotions. And I'm like, right, this is this thing. I seem to be out of capacity. I'm going to be really mad at this thing. And I'm in the middle of getting fuel and I don't want to leave, but I kind of want to leave. But I'm going to get this thing done, even though I'm really angry at this whole system. And it's my fault because I was the one pressing the buttons, right? So I did it again. And in the second time, I put in my credit card, I put in the zip code, did it again. I missed the zip code by a digit. I hit return before I saw the error and I had to wait 3 more minutes. And now I'm even more crazy and angry. And then the third time's a charm. I'll take it, got my fuel, got in the car, was a little grouchy for a little while. And then I kind of laughed because I recognized in the middle of it, I was having this reaction. I am mad at this thing because it's interfering with my life. I don't have time for this, right? So if you ever catch yourself, I don't have time for this. You're in the middle of something that is asking for you to be aware. And so when we can get those types of patterns, we're good to go. And now we have a little bit more awareness. We don't know necessarily what got us here to the middle of this crazy, but we know we're in it. And sometimes we can shake it off and keep going. And sometimes we can't. We have to ride it out until the end and then go, whew, okay. It was better than last time because at least I knew I was in it instead of feeling about it after the fact or experiencing or thinking about it after the fact. And the third level of awareness is that point at the beginning. And by the way, this is what we're striving to do. This is what we're looking to be second nature. Is when we've got that first thing, we're trying to get to this third thing. When we've got the second one where we're in the middle of it, we're trying to get to this third one, which is what's the point where we get to make the choice? Are we going to go down that pattern, that place of pattern, or are we going to choose something different? That is the awareness that we are looking for, that split secondness that we may or may not recognize in the moment, changes the course of the day. If I had just laughed it off at the beginning, or if I had said, man, I really don't have time to put fuel in the car, I can wait until the next time I'm out. Those are two options that I could have done in that situation. Now, I didn't that time. I've done it in the past. So not only one, is it hard to get to that point where you're like, oh, look, I can see. Here's the place I'm going to go down that path that I always go down, the process that I always go down, or I can choose something different versus being in the middle of it. Oh, here I am again. Or at the end, man, I hate feeling this way when that happens. And those are the three levels of awareness. We've got them now documented. I actually wish I had, okay, note to self, this is something that will come at some point, is having this all written down. I've said it different ways over the course of years, but let's write this down. And the concept of these three levels of awareness, though, is that we need to embrace the what's in our past. We need to embrace self-forgiveness, like Scott talked about, and Nadine talked about as well. And recognizing that when we can give the benefit of the doubt to others, it might just be that little bit of extra space they need to work on their awareness as well. Okay, coming back to the question from Mick, it has finally come all the way in. Hashtag VBB Radio. How do you know when it is time to actually abandon the course, to change it? Giving up on one thing or changing is a strategy too, when we know it's a good thing to do. When is it time to abandon the course? Well, with what we're going to talk about next, so this is the preempt piece, a present retreat. When we talk about a present retreat, we're talking about looking at things on a regular basis so that we're always course correcting instead of changing. There are times where we have patterns, we have processes. The easiest, by the way, and I'm going to use technology because it's way easier to describe than emotions or interactions or soft skills at this moment. So when a company gets new technology, the decision to just get new technology and telling everybody is not the way that it goes. When it's time to change technology, there's usually a reason. It's outdated, it's not supported, or it's been outgrown, or the direction that the company is going is diverging from from what the core of the software does, what that particular application, that particular technology. And so when that happens, there's always a whole bunch of discussion. Is this the right thing to do? Is it time to abandon, to change our existing technology? And when that decision is an affirmative, there are a lot of things that go into that. Where are we at now? What are our competitors doing? What is our industry in general doing? How are our customers reacting to that industry? Okay, that's all part of it, all included in the decision to abandon, to change what we have for something different. And then there's the next piece, the lump sum, is how are we going to communicate this to our team? It doesn't matter how small or big the team is, everybody reacts badly to change like this. Nobody wants new technology. Everybody just figured out the one that they had. Maybe they don't even feel comfortable with the one that they have yet. Now they're being told it's going to change again, right? All of those things happen. Well, there's a whole communication process that goes into this. How do we talk about this with our teams? How do we talk about this with our inside stakeholders? Well, when we present retreat, we're figuring out what those messages are and the reasons why. The other part of that is when we are making a decision, when the people around us are feeling like that, man, not again, I hate change, it means change has not been communicated well enough for them to understand. Our goal as leaders, our goal in the decisions that we make, all come down to that. And our ability to do it successfully with longevity is how well do we communicate right now about this thing? We know it's new. Here's what we're trying to do in 2025, and this helps us now. By the way, in some of the installations we're talking about, it wouldn't be until like 2030 or 2035. We're still going to just stick with 2020 right now. And here's what we see. Here's where we're going. This is a shift we're making. Here's how we stay true to our mission. And this is the decision. Now, people may or may not agree, but at least they've been told. And when they understand there's a reason behind it and it wasn't made willy nilly and it's not somebody's pet project, and it actually has a purpose, there's still going to be angst. There's still going to be dissonance about the implementation and the change itself. However, it's not as bad as people digging their heels in, because it's just whatever they think it is, because they don't know any better, because nobody said anything. And that's on us as the leaders, by the way. It's on us as the leaders to do the communication around the fact there is going to be a big change. And by the way, I'm also going to put it on us as the employees. It is on us as the employees to be talking and asking questions and digging into the goals that we have been given and better understand how we can do our role the best that we can, not only for personal fulfillment. Actually, maybe it should be the other way around. Not only for potential advancement, but for personal fulfillment. There it is. For the contribution that you make, not only to your team employee, your company as an employee, your community as an employee that works there, and the world for being part of a bigger mission to solve something and to make the world better in its very specific way. The way that your company does. Okay, so that goes into the third piece, which is we do it. We've made the change. How do we make it last? Which, by the way, wasn't part of Mick's question, but I'm going to go there so we can wrap that part up. And that is, yes, everything that we do in our business, everything, a product that we have, a process that we have, a technology that we have, the people we have, us. I mean, if we're looking at the business as an entity, us within our business, right? Or in the business, it's going to have a beginning, a middle, and an end. We showed up, we did what we could, and then we're done. Everything has a beginning, a middle, and an end. Thank you, Scott, because you tell me that all the time. And it's seeped in beyond what we do at the Voice of Bold Business or what we do when I create little snippets and things. It's everything. And it's true. It's everything.
Yeah, and I was smiling. I off camera, I was smiling, and you saw me do that because we've had this discussion before.
Yeah, we have. And so, yes, at some point we have to make the decision to change, not because it was the wrong decision or we're behind the eight ball or anything like that, but because it's done. The thing has run its course. The relationship, the technology, the capacity of the person, the willingness of the person to continue to do and evolve as the company continues to do and evolve. So it goes, the list goes on. So there are three pieces to that, Mick, and that may have been longer than you wanted. There you go. But there you go. So then with that, where we were talking about awareness, we went into this, I teased present retreat. Now may be the time. 1, 2, 3. We have, and let's go ahead and play Michael Rosenblum's clip.
We have to have continuous motion in order to be able to get to that brilliance and shine, kind of like the sun. It goes down at night, so the moon comes up, but then it rises the next day. It has for billions of years. It's no different than with us as people. As we journey through our lifespan, we have to initiate some sort of change or movement, like the sun, which repositions itself constantly throughout the day while it's awake. And why should we be any different? And I think that's what's so important.
Why should we be any different? Momentum. Whether we have to go take a walk to be able to do our work, whether we can sit in silence and think in our brain and create something wonderful that comes out of us in the work that we do. Maybe we're the ones that, maybe we plan it out on sticky notes first, and then we figure out that's how we get to the point where we can actually do work. Well, the thing is, all those, the sitting, the sticky notes, the walk, they're all ways to create energetic momentum. And when we don't have any, those are simple ways to start. Now, one of the things that I really like about what Michael said is that we're really talking about stopping and taking stock and understanding where our energy is, the focus, the hats that we're wearing, the focus we're giving them, and then being able to evaluate. Are they the right hats that are getting the focus right now? Are these the right priorities that are getting the attention right now? How do these priorities that we've set impact our culture? And is what we're talking about actually what we're doing? And are the rewards or the outcomes or what we're talking about from the results of our work what we praise, right? All of these things wrap into something that I have started to call a present retreat. It's protected time to think, to dream, and to work through and grapple with how we get not only to like this year's goals, but to the 2025 goals. And then when we're already thinking to the 2025 goals, as we get closer, we're going to start thinking about to the 2030 goals, the 2035 goals. I mean, it's kind of crazy to think about. And so when we don't take time to do that, we're really missing out. And it's much more likely that in chaos, we will lose course versus stay the course. And I'm interested to hear, Scott, what your thoughts are. You've heard me now mention, you know, present retreat a couple of times. What's your take on it?
Well, thanks for asking. It's something that we all have been told to do all the time, and that is go to the 20,000 foot level and then look down to see what the situation is. That takes you out of yourself and removes a lot of the observations that you might have, maybe take away some of the emotions and whatnot. And you'll be able to, if you're looking down, think about what it is. You can see the path up to where you've been right now, and you can see where you are now. And then you can, because you're so high, you can see the path that if you stay on the current path, what terrain you'll be going through, but you can see what other terrain that there might be out there as well. There's a concept of artificial intelligence where it takes all of these disparate points, and even though they don't seem related, it sees patterns and connections and ties them together and comes up with solutions or comes up with answers that are not necessarily obvious. Well, I would say that there's something beyond, even better than artificial intelligence.
I'm ready for it.
Okay. It's real intelligence, because our brain is so much more complex in so many different ways than the computers that are out there that are very much into silos. So our brains have the capacity to be able to do everything, I think, based on what you're saying with present retreat, that artificial intelligence does, but it can do it much better. But it can't do it as long as there's too much of a noise to signal ratio. If one kind of clears one's mind and allows things to seep in from the different places, these different points, and then be able to connect them. And the brain does it automatically underneath if you allow it and you encourage it and you get the time and the space to do it. So for me, your present retreat is just laying the table to allow, well, maybe it's wisdom to come out or intuition or, you know, all of those things that make the human condition and make us approach our human potential occur. Not when we're at the gas station and angry and frustrated with the credit card, but when we're relaxed in an environment that we can focus in and really figure out what's important.
Exactly. And that's, yes, because it expands our capacity in those moments to increase our awareness. And when we're increasing our awareness, we are better equipped to communicate so that we can help others understand what's happening so that they can practice their awareness, which then goes back to the very beginning of it's all what we prioritize and what problems we solve and the way that we choose to work together. And so, Scott, you did a really great job of that. All I thought was, you started talking about AI and all these disparate pieces, and I was like, well, there's the end of what Jess does, because that's Jess's secret sauce. And then you went on to say, but the brain will always, you know, and I would say, yes, the brain plus the heart plus the gut will always.
Well, two things. One is you've also brought in the concept of the gut as being part of the overall picture, a third brain, as it were, if you also include the heart. You've been doing present retreat for quite a while. So, what is the benefit curve I mean, I think I'd be disingenuous if I were to just say, well, do you get better over time?
But yes.
Could you?
And you sometimes lapse, right? I mean, we just had the growth summit, and right before and right after the growth summit, the weeks around that, my present retreats were eroded, and I can actually tell. I can tell I haven't engaged with the growth strategy for Red Direction in a few weeks, because when things come up, I'm like, oh, well, oh. And I have to actually expend more energy making decisions or thinking about them. And right now I'm putting them off, most of them, because I'm like, I don't even know if I'm ready to make a decision. So being able to seem like you're in flow comes from purposeful action. And that purposeful action and protecting that time to intuit, to be empathetic, to grapple with things, to decide what we need to solve, to figure out if we are solving the right problems, all become part of our regular process. And when it becomes part of our regular process, we as leaders talk about it. And then the more we talk about it, the more those around us talk about it. Because I was thinking about the crying, right? I was like, oh yeah, I did. I broke down. And I actually wasn't, I was breaking down because I was overwhelmed right before the summit. We had a meeting and I was in tears, but I was overwhelmed. I wasn't overwhelmed by any one thing. I was overwhelmed by everything. It was the coolest ride ever. And I finally felt like I was hanging on by my, you know, by the seat of my pants, flying by the seat of my pants just a little too long. And I didn't have a few present retreats. And so I didn't really have something to ground in the short term, right? I can ground every week into something that comes from our past, a year or more out, and our future, more than a year out, at any point in time. And that context is really important. And by the way, that's the bold part. It's bold to stay the course. It's bold to be consistent, and it's bold to do something that not many people will take time for, because most people will say, I don't have time for that. Well, if you don't have time for a present retreat, then you don't have time to prioritize communication. So it means you're not talking about awareness, which means who knows what problems you're solving, even though you're seeing results and you're solving problems. Are they the ones you want for the course that has been given to you, set by an executive team, set by you to where you want to go? Now, we are going to go ahead and close because it is 11:50. However, if we can, when we're done with the close, we're going to stay on air because we do have one more question that I would like to address, and we'll just lump it in after. This is a great show. Hashtag VBB Radio. Program 205. Stay the course. Keep this conversation going. Rate this program. We will.
The Voice of Bold Business Radio gives you insights about how to achieve your company's growth strategy. Use hashtag BBB Radio or email us at radio@reddirection.com to ask questions and share your experiences. Add your voice to the conversation. Together, we define what being an effective leader means today. Special thanks to the Scott Treatment for technical production. Thank you for joining us.
Okay, everybody. This is a question from Stephanie, and she is asking, what would be the good way to motivate people to stick with change? Because sometimes the benefits are not always visible, but the growing pains are very visible. And, you know, all I can think back to is anybody who has a child right now, think about when they start getting their teeth. You can't talk to them. They're too little to really understand. You can be there. You can hold the space. You can give them things to put in their mouths, to chew on, to ice to help numb it, whatever you're going to do, right? But it doesn't change the fact that it's just happening. And when it's done, they don't remember. You remember the craziness and tell them stories about it when they get older. But they don't remember that when they were going through it because it was part of the journey. So there's one example that comes to mind. Just in life that we can adopt and be like, what if we were more curious about that? What if we just said, yeah, we do have growing pains. And yeah, we don't know how long they're going to take. We're in this together. That's one approach. Another one would be, how do we motivate people to stick with the change? Well, when they've been communicated with about a growth strategy, when they understand how their role ties to the mission and delivering the product, the way the product solves the problem to create this bigger vision in the world, there's already a different connection to what the company is doing. So any change that needs to be gone through, growing pains or not, right? I mean, it could be you're growing so fast, you can't hire enough people fast enough to deal with the texts and the social media and the email support and the phone support that's coming in. I've been in a situation like that. Didn't have text back then, but we had phone and email and forums, right? All online, and we were watching those all the time, and we couldn't keep up. We got to the point, each of us were answering 300 contacts a day, and we weren't doing our own respective jobs because we couldn't even find the time to hire somebody and all of that until I said, you know what? We're going to have to wait. We're going to have to let our response time suffer because we got to get something has to give so that we can keep growing. So when we get into that growth pattern, sometimes it's easy to stay in the, oh, we're going to do this. We're going to have this crazy amount of response and contact and everything all the time or whatever it is, like, right? Things that take up tasks are the easiest to track around this. We get into a frantic mode and we get into a mode of going. And then when we try and help people go less, what happens? They are freaking out because they're not sure. They know how they do it now, and they don't like it, but it works for them. And anything new not only might not work for them, it might blow up what they've decided that they feel accomplished doing. And so it's all about communication. And when we can, be proactive. And when we can't, really support along the way. Communicate, communicate, communicate.